When I was about 18 years old or so, that's when the Lord called me into ministry. Now, I did not ever sense a specific call to children's ministry. It wasn't something I naturally would have jumped into, but it was an opening. At the time of my church, they needed volunteers there, as, my word, any church seems to need, and I jumped in. And very quickly, very early on in my ministry, there was a text that I kind of latched onto. There's two texts, and I'm going to share both of them with you momentarily. But this first text that really just kind of gripped me, this was a text that kind of led me to start thinking about children's ministry, and in particular, parenthood in general, well before I'd even met my wife, Lauren. It's a text some of you may have heard, and some of you may have even heard me share this with you before. In Psalm chapter 127, verse 4, I just want to draw your attention to this verse, and it's actually printed, I believe, at the bottom of the first page of your outline. Psalm 127, verse 4 says this, "Like arrows in the hands of a warrior are the children of one's youth." So let's just take the analogy that the psalmist has given us. He's describing the children that God has given you. He's described them like an arrow. Now let me just ask, I hope this isn't like a dumb question for you guys, but what do you do with an arrow? What do you do with it? Do you take it back, pull that arrow back, and then just aim high? It's a good thing to aim high and just hope for the best. Of course not. Do you just take the arrow, close your eyes, and aim at something, at least it's going to go somewhere in life, and hope for the best? Of course not. What do you do with an arrow? You aim the arrow at a target. And the question that you ought to be asking, if you haven't done so already, that should be central in your mind is, God has given you an arrow. He has entrusted, the psalm even describes it as a quiver full of arrows. Some of you have a quiver full. And the question that is going to be overarching our entire night together is this. What's your target? Where are you aiming your arrow? The reason this is a very important question to ask is because all too often we tend to aim our arrows that God has given us, even well-intentioned, we tend to aim these arrows at poor targets. We tend to aim them at targets that man loves. And so before Kyle comes up and gives us some basics of family discipleship, let's just begin by thinking in terms of this. What are some common targets that parents, and I'm not talking parents out there, I'm talking parents in here at Hickory Grove, what are some common targets well-intentioned parents tend to aim their children at, their arrows, so to speak? And then we'll just look, lastly, at the target that God has clearly given us in His Word. So let's just think real briefly, what are some common targets? I suspect that all of you would agree with these four targets because they really are that common. One thing that I tend to see more often than anything is this. Parents tend to aim this way. They really want children. They desperately want children who love themselves, meaning the parent. They want children who love me. And I wonder if any of you have ever found yourself in that position where your aim is to have a child who loves you. Maybe your greatest desire is to provide for your child something that your parent was unable to provide for you. Or maybe you desperately desire that your child have a relationship with you that you never seem to be able to have with your parent. Is that your main goal? Now you're going to have, this is something that I can't discern for you. Your spouse may not even be able to discern for you. This is something that you're going to have to discern. Where is my bottom motivation with my child? Do I desperately want my child to love me? That's number one. That's one common target. Here's another target. People all too often also want children who love themselves. Now, this has become very common in our day and age. Parents who desperately want their children to build this significant sense of self-esteem. Or parents who desperately want their children to figure out their new identity. Now, I know this is a pretty far-fetched example. I suspect none of us in this room have dealt with this, but you're seeing articles all around now of parents who are letting their children dictate what they learn. So you see these schools popping up where children determine their own curriculum, or you can go to an even bigger extreme, and there's parents that are letting their children discern their own sexual identity. Before, my word, they're even like 6 years old. Those are extremes. So let's just move away from those extremes. I want you to just get a little closer to home, something that may seem a little bit more realistic to you. Do you find that your base motivation with your child, do you find the target you tend to be aiming, the little arrow that God's given you, is to make sure that that child feels a sense of, okay, I've got this. You're making sure your child has this sense of, okay, I'm worthy, I'm loved, I'm good, I'm perfect, I can do things, I can change the world. Now, some of you may be hearing this and saying, my word, what's so wrong about that? Don't you want to build some self-esteem? We're going to talk about that momentarily. But that's the second common target that I'm going to make an argument in a moment, tends to miss the mark. That's number two. Here's a third way, and if you're filling in the blanks, keeping score, number three, a third way that parents tend to, third target that parents tend to aim their children at that just seems to fall short is these are parents who want their children to be moral. Children who are moral children. You want to know something? Many of you, raise your hand if you have any children that are in a Awana program. Anybody got Awana kids? Great. Well, Awana is a tremendous ministry. Kyle and I love it. That's why we worked hard to bring it here. But here is something that happens with Awana and other ministries. I'm just picking on Awana for a moment. Awana has a propensity, if parents aren't intentional, to create little moral Bible whizzes that are headed for hell. And I mean that as serious as I can. Romans 1 describes a child, describes a person who is as upright a citizen as they come, who can shoot off all the books of the Bible, who is more morally exemplary than maybe some of you are as parents. And yet the scripture is very clear that your moral uprightness has nothing to do with your eternal destiny. Is that your biggest aim? Is your biggest aim to have a child who doesn't do drugs, who doesn't drink, who doesn't mess around? Is your biggest goal to have a child who stays out of trouble in school? These seem like worthy goals. Is that the target, the ultimate target, you're aiming the arrow God's given you? Or perhaps this last one might hit closest to home. It tends to for most people. All too often, parents ultimately aim for children who are successful. And man, that is a tough one because every loving parent wants this for their child. But is that your ultimate goal? Is your ultimate goal to have a child who is athletically successful? Now, on the surface, you may say, while that is a secondary motivation, it's not my chief one. And we're going to explore that mindset in a moment. Is your greatest goal for your child to be academically successful? Some of you may say, again, that's a secondary motivation. It's not my chief. Well, we're going to explore that in a moment. Because here's the bottom line. Your priorities communicate what you value the most. That's not a fill in the blank, but I encourage you to write it down if you think that could be something that could help you long term. Because here's the bottom line. Your children can see what you ultimately prioritize. They know it. They know what's most important to you. Do you notice what's the common thread, the common problem with all four of those targets I've mentioned? All of which, in certain circumstances, may sound good. But the bottom problem with all of those is they have a terrible priority problem. They are good things, but if they are your priority, there is something off. And I wonder if these priorities are being manifested in your home. This is something you don't have to do. Some of you may like to try this. It's probably going to be humbling. But if you have a child that's old enough to notice these things, go home tonight. Sit down with your child, or maybe tomorrow, and just sit down and ask. Explain what a priority is. The child will understand that basic concept. And just ask them, say, hey, what do you think's most important in our home? What do mom and daddy like the most? Some of you may be nervous to ask that question to your child, because what they're going to say is not what you want to be true. They're going to say what you have communicated is true. So I just illustrate from my own life. I grew up in a Christian home, a dear mom and dad who loved the Lord. But when I was growing up, there was many a Sunday where we slept in. We would sit out in the living room, read the newspaper, watch HGTV on TV, and mom and dad, all of a sudden 9 o'clock would roll around, and we're like, okay, well, I guess we're going to miss Sunday school, but we'll go to service. And then it'd keep going, and mom makes another pot of coffee, and it's like, oh, you know what, we got housework to do. We'll just take the day off. They thought that was completely innocuous. It happened several times, but, you know, it was sporadic. What were they communicating inadvertently? This is the benefit of the doubt. What were they communicating to me and to my brother and to my sister? They were communicating that church is an option. Church is valued when it's a priority and only when it's convenient. But if I have any whim that leads me to not feel like going there, it no longer becomes a priority. Here's one that might step on a few more toes. When a ball game or a travel tournament takes precedence over the local church. Now, the reason I say this with a smile is because I recognize for the great majority of you, you have no idea what this is even communicating. For most of you, you probably think, yeah, well, the team's depending on us. We paid a lot of money. We got to go. It's a great family trip together. There's a lot of great reasons, just like all the four targets I just listed are great reasons. But I wonder, what is it that you are subtly communicating? Because once again, the bottom line is what you prioritize communicates, whether you want it to or not. It communicates what you value the most. And so some of this just may feel kind of heavy. And if you feel kind of like this sense of my word, this is a, I feel like an extra burden on my shoulders, then you're in good company. Because every parent I've ever met feels inadequate on the front end and guilty on the back end. There's not a single parent I've ever met, apart from some crazy ones, who feel like they've got it all figured out. And so if you have this sense of my word, I'm not quite sure what to do. If you have this sense that my word, I feel like all of my imperfections are just being magnified through my parenting, you're in good company. Everybody's like that. Parenting is like a magnifying glass. It shows all the warts you got. It shows that you really don't have it all together. And this is why you desperately need something else. You can't let your friend, you can't let your culture, you can't let your circle dictate what is worthy of being prioritized. You must go to the one thing that clearly reflects who you are. And of course, y'all know that to be the Word of God. And so what I just want to do is give you one quick verse before I hand it off to Kyle. And this verse is going to kind of, this is going to kind of like permeate everything else we say. Because Kyle's going to come up here, he's going to give you a lot of tips. He's going to give you a lot of things that he's just thought through, some ideas that can help you get started with family discipleship. But let this kind of permeate everything that's said from this point forward. God has clearly given each and every one of us a target. This isn't an arbitrary thing where whatever target you choose is good for you and whatever target you choose is good for you. There is a target that God has given. And the place in the Bible that has been nearest and dearest to my heart when I think of the calling of a parent is Psalm 78. I don't have the text on the screen, but it's such a short verse, I'm just going to recite it right off the top of my head, and it's going to be something you can grasp onto. Because in Psalm 78, this is just a random psalm, it seems, where God is talking about these Israelite parents and the calling God has given these Israelite parents. And there's one verse, if you just want to write this down, verse number 7 of Psalm 78. Psalm 78, 7 says this, and this has been the motto, a personal motto for me when it comes to the ministry the Lord's entrusted me as a children's pastor, and I'm sure of Kyle Scarlett as well, and I pray it would be something near and dear to your heart as you parent the arrows God has given you, and that is this. Psalm 78 says this. I'm going to give my own paraphrase. God's goal for you as a parent is this, that your children, here's the verse, might set their hope in God. Write that down if you'd like. Children who hope in God. And then put in parenthesis Psalm 78, 7. I want you to go back to that verse, perhaps on your own time. Because in this verse, I want you to hear the implication. Your target as a parent is to raise children whose hope is not set in you. And you, I wonder if some of you are seeing that this is really prevalent. Your target as a parent is not to raise children who set their hope in themselves. And that's becoming all the more prevalent. Your target as a parent is not to raise children who set their hope in success. Your target as a parent is not to raise children who set their hope in their goodness, their morality. Our prayer is that your children would have their hope set in God. And what this might look like is your target as a parent is to raise a child who has utter dependence on God, who is depending on God for every breath they breathe, a child who sees that God is greater than anything mom and dad have to offer, a child who truly, it can be said, their treasure is Christ himself, who demonstrates literally and figuratively a childlike faith in God, a child who trusts God just as much as he trusts daddy, just as much as he loves mommy. A child who looks to God and says, you are everything I need. That is our goal. That is our target. That is our hope. And as Kyle comes to share tips, you'll notice that every one of these little practices that you could maybe start implementing in your home, regardless of the ages, the goal is not to make successful, moral children who love you and have great self-esteem. Our goal, our prayer, is that through these practices that you may begin in your home, discipling your children, that their hope might be set in God. And so, why don't you guys all welcome Kyle Scarlett, the seasoned parent, who's going to share some stuff with us. Brother Kyle.
The seasoned parent. It's mighty presumptuous. You know, I think my family experience growing up was a whole lot different than Kyler's. My dad is a pastor. He's a retired pastor. He pastored for, my goodness, probably 35, 40 years. And we grew up, my church upbringing was always in small rural churches in Alabama and Tennessee. And we were the kind that, I mean, we didn't miss church for anything. I remember I have an older sister and a younger brother. We never missed church for anything. And I remember even one night on Sunday night, it was kind of icy and snowy. It was Super Bowl Sunday. We had church, and we went to church, and we were the only ones at church for the entire time, and we still had church, just the five of us. So there was no HGTV or anything back then. We were always in church. And I say that to say, I grew up with the influence of always being in the church, but a little bit of my testimony is I came to Christ at an early age. But, later on when I got to middle school and high school years, I just wasn't that interested. I wasn't that interested in being discipled. I wasn't that interested in focusing on the things of the Lord. And so I stand here as a testimony of grace. I feel like, and I look back and I think, man, my parents probably did everything that they could and everything that they knew that was right and that was good and that was biblical at the time. But there are still times that are tough. There are still times that are going to be struggles, and there are still times where we wonder ourselves, am I doing the right thing? Am I pointing them to Christ? And, in college, God just worked in my life and his grace. And so beyond the things that we say tonight, we need to look to God and for his grace and ask him to bestow his grace upon us as we seek this awesome responsibility of parenting. And I was thinking about, as we think through some practical tips on how to disciple our children and focus our homes on God's word, I think the one thing that kept coming over and over to me when I was thinking about, how do we really focus in on this, is this idea of being intentional. Every tip that I give tonight, or every fill in the blank that you write down, the focus should be on how do I become more intentional about what I'm doing or about what I know I ought to be doing? How can I make sure that I have this purpose? How can I be more intentional about discipling my children? And, really for us, the place where this starts is it begins within. It begins with us. It begins with our own walk with the Lord. You go all the way back over to the probably the quintessential passage of family discipleship in Deuteronomy chapter 6. And it says this in verse number 4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. So the whole idea here is that we must begin within. What you and I have to do is that we have to discipline ourselves for godliness. That's the number one goal. We can say all day, hey, I want to disciple my kids and I want to see my kids walk with the Lord. But what about us? It begins within, and you and I must discipline ourselves for godliness. Over in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7, it says, Paul was talking to Timothy and he said, train yourself for godliness. It doesn't just happen, but you need to continually discipline and train yourself for godliness. Paul was talking to Timothy and he said, this is you need to know the truth of God's word, but you also need to live it out in your lifestyle. People need to be able to look at you and say, hey, he not only says what he believes, but he lives it out. He walks it out. And the problem a lot of times that we see with parents and even maybe some of us in this room is we don't disciple our own children because we're not walking closely with the Lord. And we wonder and we scratch our head, man, I'm taking them to church all the time. They're in VBS or they're in Sunday school or WANA or whatever. We say, I'm not quite sure where the disconnect is. But a lot of it starts with us. How am I doing? How are you doing in my own personal quiet times? When's the last time that my children have seen or I know that I've been able to share my faith with sometime? What is my own prayer life like? We have to discipline ourselves for godliness. And the second thing is, Kyler already talked about this, but that we must treasure Jesus genuinely in our home. We have to treasure Jesus genuinely above all things in our home. It begins with you and I. We could talk about these other things that where does Jesus rank on the list of these priorities? And Kyler already asked that question. We want our kids to get into good school or have a good career and do well in sports and entertainment and all these other things. But if we were to open up the treasure chest of our heart, where would our children see where Christ ranks? Is he near the top or is he somewhere down where we don't even recognize him anymore? You know, ultimately, it is our goal to make sure that you and I treasure Jesus above all things. Now, I think the scary part about this and about even standing up here and talking is, as I walked out before the breakout happened, somebody was like, hey, you're going to whip them into shape. And that's a terrifying thought. And I'm like, you know, probably not. Because ultimately, it's really in the hands of the Lord. We're doing the things that he has called us to do. And sometimes we're trusting and we're asking for God's grace and his mercy on our lives. And so tonight, I just want to talk through some practical tips. Just some things. I've been a parent now for, I guess, 13 years. I have three children ranging from the age of 4 years old, almost 4 years old, all the way up to 12 years old. I got more children or child on the way. And so I'm not really sure. I don't know how many are coming. We'll see. We'll just wait and find out when they show up. It'll be great. So, you know, it's really hard sometimes because you think about this and you talk about it. We have an idea that handing out tips or talking about some basics of family discipleship, the problem sometimes is that we can run into is like, hey, man, that guy is doing a lot of things. Or man, I could never do that many things. But once again, I want you to think about the idea of what are a few areas that I can walk away from here tonight and be intentional about in discipling my children. So we start with beginning within with ourselves and our own walk with the Lord. But then we move to where we focus on the family. Okay, we start thinking about focusing on our own family. And those of you that have been around Hickory Grove for any amount of time, Kyler came up with this, and I thought it was a great idea. If you are aware of who we are as a church and what we are built on, we're going to walk through basically the five objectives, because they're all very applicable to our own walks with the Lord, but then also how we disciple our children. And so the first thing I want you to write down, the first blank, is worship as a family. You worship as a family. We do this in the home is the first place where we want to do this. We always think about worshiping. We come on Sunday and we sit under Pastor Gerald or Pastor John and we listen to the pastor. But it really starts in our home. We can have periodic or weekly family worship. Sometimes we do this in our house, and I'll probably many of you do this as well. But what does that look like? How do we open up God's word? A simple devotion, but doing anything that we do based on God's word. It can be made up of three components. We're going to open the Bible, we're going to read it, we're going to sing, and we're going to pray. But in the home is where we should be worshiping as a family. And the one thing is, you know, no matter how young your children are, we want everyone to participate. From the youngest all the way to the oldest, we want everybody to participate. We want to make sure it's age appropriate, but we can worship together in the home. Back in March of last year when David Platt was here for Secret Church, several of us were having lunch with him one day, and somebody asked him the question. This took so much heat off of me, or I felt so relieved. Somebody asked him the question about, you know, what are some things that you do in your home for family discipleship? And we're all kind of leaning in, hoping he's going to say something just that's going to blow us away. And he's like, you know, sometimes we sing deep and wide and the B-I-B-L-E, and it ends up in a wrestling match. And I'm like, I feel a lot better about how family discipleship looks like in my house, because if David Platt is saying that, the heat is off. But the whole idea there is that we are worshiping together as a family. If that's not a practice that you're already doing in your home, just start. Be intentional about how can you open up God's word, how can we sing together, and how can we pray. So we're doing that in the home, but then we're also doing it in the actual worship service. On a Sunday morning, in the worship service, mom and dad, we need to be the ones who are worshiping as a family. We are setting the tone for what our children see and what they believe and how they respond in worship. Bring your children to worship. Kyler and I have this conversation all the time. We get questions about when is it appropriate, at what age. Man, if you can bring them the earlier, the better. Pastor Clint loves distractions in the services, so go ahead and bring your infants in at any time. But as a rule of thumb, we probably would say, you know, kindergarten, first grade, when they get to that age, it's a struggle. I have a third grader, and so a couple years ago, we were going through that process of, I got this fidgety five-year-old or this six-year-old who can't sit still and has to get up and go to the bathroom. But, you know, we're a couple years removed from that now. And there are opportunities that we've been able to worship together as a family right there in the worship service. They want to participate. We're not there just to be spectators. And I say this especially to dads. Sometimes I hear dads say, I don't like to sing, and you know, I get kind of bored in church. And our kids pick up on that. Fathers, we need to be the ones setting the tone for the worship of our family in the actual worship service. We need to sing. We need to sing loud. We need to sing horribly. We need to be participating in the worship. We need to open up our Bibles. We need to follow along. We need to help our children open up their Bibles. We need to pray, and we need to respond. Our kids need to see us responding in worship. And what does that look like for them to look and see my mom and to see my dad worshiping this one true God? So we worship together as a family. That's the first objective. The second objective is this, is we need to connect as a family. We want to connect as a family. There's a couple things that I thought of kind of practical ways that we can do this. We connect through the gospel. You and I, we want to connect with our kids through the gospel. We want to talk about the gospel all the time. I think one of the mistakes that we make as parents is like, hey, I had to talk with my kid when they were 5 years old, or I shared the gospel with my kid when they were 7 years old, but that was the only time we ever talked about it. Instead, we need the gospel daily in our own lives. It should be a piece of conversation where we're always talking about Christ. We're always talking about God's goodness. We're always talking about our sinfulness. We're always talking about how Christ has come and he's here to rescue us and give us a new life and how we respond to that. Even this afternoon at lunch today, we had the Lord's Supper here at Hickory Grove, and my own child, my middle child, she has made a profession of faith. She has trusted Christ. She's still a little nervous about baptism. It was an opportunity for us to, over lunch, continue to have the conversation and talk about the gospel. We just bring it up naturally. Every day of our life, we should be talking about the gospel. So we connect through the gospel. Then we connect through discipline. We should discipline as parents. We should discipline like we believe the gospel. Like we actually believe the gospel that we say we proclaim. This is how we should discipline. This should manifest itself in the way that we love our children, in the way that we show them mercy at times, in the way that we show them grace, in the way that we extend forgiveness, and even sometimes when wrath must be extended as well. All of these are components of the gospel, and yet we need to discipline with that in mind. We need to discipline with the gospel in mind. We also need to connect through accountability. And for those of us that have older children, maybe middle school years, this is something that we have found has actually been pretty beneficial in our home, is it's okay to ask your kids, how's your walk with the Lord? Sometimes we think, well, I'm hoping that they're reading their Bible, or I'm hoping that they're praying, or I've seen them having a quiet time. But ask them specific questions. Hey, I mean, what did you read this morning? I know if we have younger children, this doesn't apply yet, but especially as they get older, you know, what are you reading? Do you have a plan to read the Bible this year? Or do you have a devotion that you're reading through? Or one of the ones that we do is keeping them accountable is, what can I pray specifically for you about? What's going on in your life at school where I can pray specifically? But we connect through accountability. And then the last one is this, and I think this was a huge turning point for me, is we connect through everyday things. Just everyday things. A lot of times we focus on the event, or we focus on the ministry, we focus on church. But how do we connect with our kids and with the gospel at the center of what we're doing in everyday things? Deuteronomy 6:7 says, "You shall teach them diligently to your children, and you shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up." Those are things that we do every day. And Moses was saying, this is when you should teach them the law of the Lord. This is when you should remind them about the gospel. But this is where we have to be really intentional, because a lot of times we can go through mundane things of life and the regular things that we do every day without ever bringing up Christ, without ever pointing our kids back to God. We need to figure out ways to redeem everyday things. The trip to the store, the sunrise that we see in the morning, the accident that we saw on the way down the road. How can we talk about the things and then point them back, point our children back to Christ? And bedtimes. I know many of us probably do this, and this is probably maybe, it may kind of summarize our family discipleship, is that we read a story before we go to bed. We do this in my house as well. I have all girls, so there's not a lot of wrestling matches, but there are usually like dance parties do break out, and that's okay. And so I come down 15, 20 minutes later, my wife is like, "What in the world were you guys doing?" And I'm just like, family discipleship, that's what it is right there. But you can use that bedtime as a time for you to connect in an everyday thing. You're putting your kids to sleep. Sometimes our kids act like they don't want to go to sleep, and I know it's crazy to put your kids down and hopefully get a good night's rest. But use that time, that last moment before they go to sleep, to give them something to think about that focuses our minds and their hearts on the Lord. Mealtimes, activities, things that you normally do, how can we redeem those things and be intentional about connecting our family to the gospel of Jesus Christ? So we worship as a family, we connect as a family, and the third thing is that we serve as a family. We serve as a family. When I was doing kind of my own, when I was thinking about how I do about this, how well I do with this, and then how well we do this as a family, this is probably an area where maybe I was a little bit deficient. But how do we serve as a family? There's a couple places, two main places where we can do this. We can do this in the church. We want to do this in the church. When your kids get a little bit older and you have maybe middle school or high school age children, where's a place in the church where we can serve together? Might be in a Sunday school class. As a family, as a mom and dad, and maybe your child, or two children, or three children, is there a place that we could serve in Awana? Is there a place that maybe when VBS comes up over the summer, how can we serve together as a family? Maybe those things don't work out for you, but you know, we have things like the clothes closet or the food pantry, where you can volunteer together as a family, but you can serve as a family. We do that in the church, but then also we want to serve in the community. We want to serve in the community, not just here at church. I said it's not just something that we do on Sunday and we do around the people that we know and love, but what about people that don't know God? What about the people that are not believers? We have to be intentional. You and I have to be intentional about being a missional family. A couple things that I thought of that we're doing, one of the things that we're working on in our home is we want our home to be that house. We want our home to be the hangout house for the road, for the street. There's about 15, 16 houses on the street. We happen to be right in the middle. And we've just said, if people are going to hang out, if kids are going to come over, let's let it be our house. Let's use our home and where God has planted us, hopefully for the sake of the gospel. Now, you have to be careful what you wish for sometimes, because sometimes we'll have kids just sneaking in the backyard and jumping on the trampoline and things like that. But we want our house to be that place. Back at Halloween, we had a big block party, and we invited the whole street. We should be involve our kids in being more missional as a family. We can use these opportunities to get to know neighbors and to reach out to them and hopefully have opportunities to share the gospel. So you can do that, make your house the hangout house in the neighborhood. But what about mission trips? As your kids get older, I didn't go on my first mission trip until I was about 24 years old. I missed out on that opportunity. I wish my family or my parents had given me opportunities to do that. But think about, how can you get your kids to serve now, or how can you serve together? Maybe in the future you have an opportunity to go on a family mission trip together, but serve the community together. Or maybe adopt a project or a ministry where maybe it's not a Sunday morning, Sunday school, or maybe it's not Wednesday night at Awana, but instead there's something that's near and dear to your own family. But how can we serve together as a family? One of the things that happened back in October is that we had the church-wide Operation Charlotte. There was probably 15 or 20 ministries that you and I can get involved with on an ongoing basis And a lot of them will allow us to serve together as a family. One of the things that, my family did is that we went and served. We've done it once so far at the Refugee Support Center. Just little opportunities like that. It was an opportunity for my children to see people that they normally wouldn't come in contact with. It was a way for us to be able to, serve them. And then hopefully we'll have opportunities in the future to share the gospel. We also want to share the gospel with, we can do this, we can serve in our community. We share the gospel with, our neighbors. Our kids need to see that. Many of us may not be doing it, but if we're not doing it, we should be doing that. We look for opportunities to, share the gospel with the people that live right across the street from us. We made a, I lived in California before we moved here to Charlotte. I lived there for 4 years, and it was, I don't know what it was. I think it was a, combination of, what are those, Kirby vacuum salesmen, Jehovah's Witnesses, and Mormons. Somebody was knocking on our door like every day. And after about three or four times, I was like, this is unusual coming from, you know, kind of the South, the East Coast. People weren't knocking on our doors. And I just took it as a reminder that God was saying to me every time somebody knocks on your door, you should share the gospel with them. You should somehow try to steer that conversation. I'm taking that as a sign from the Lord. Hey, they're coming to my house. Let me have an opportunity to share the gospel. And what I wanted to do is let my kids be involved with that. Let them see, hey, when the people come, we don't go and close the blinds and hide. But instead, we have a conversation with them. We ask them questions. We point them to the grace of God in Jesus Christ. And we keep our children involved with us in doing that. So we serve together as a family. The fourth thing is this: we pray as a family. We want to pray together as a family. Now, this is pretty easy for a lot of us because we probably do it at mealtimes. If we're able to, get together for breakfast or maybe at dinner time and we're together as a family, maybe this kind of summarizes our own family discipleship. We pray. The problem with that sometimes is sometimes it gets a little redundant. We say the same things or we pray about the same things. If you have a creative child and they love to pray, man, it can go on and they can pray for every single thing in the universe, and that's fantastic. I actually came across an article this past week, and you can Google this and look it up, from Desiring God that talked about pray big things before you eat. I would encourage you to jot that down. If you Google Desiring God, pray big things before you eat. It's a great short little article, but it talks about four things that you can pray just to kind of mix up the routine of praying before meals. And it also helps our children focus on praying as a family, but it points them to a larger picture and a greater picture of God. It talks about comparing God to the biggest things in the universe. Talks about the provision of God making for, that God makes provision for even the smallest things on the earth. It also reminds us that God is involved in the mundane and even the miraculous rhythms of our life. And also that we are to eat and drink to the glory of God. But how can we take this prayer time as a family that sometimes may get a little redundant and we say the same thing, but how can we change it up a little bit and we can pray together as a family? One of the quotes that was in that article I thought was great was, "Make every meal a fresh call to worship King Jesus." Well, what if that was our focus before we sat down to eat a meal every night? If we're fortunate enough to do that one time a week or two or three times a week together as a family, what if that was our focus on making that meal a time for us to have a fresh call to make and to worship King Jesus? We pray together as a family at bedtimes. Maybe before you go on a long trip, just get into the habit of the discipline of let's pray together as a family. Maybe you see an emergency out. Sometimes if you see an emergency responder going out, I know a lot of families, sometimes we do this. We'll stop and we'll pray because there's something going on where there's a need of prayer at that time. And so there's an opportunity for us to focus our family and to focus them, our children, on someone else. And the fifth thing is this. The fifth objective is to give as a family. We want to give as a family. We should, at an early age, teach our children to give. And more specifically, we should teach them to tithe. And a lot of times, if you got a 3 or 4-year-old, I mean, they're not bringing in a whole lot of income, and so they can't really contribute that much. But the earlier that you start with them, and the earlier that they see this as a discipline, the easier it will be when they're 16 and 18 years old, and they're getting real jobs, and they're moving out. So we want to start early. Don't wait until they're 18. But we also need to teach them to give cheerfully. 2 Corinthians 9:7 said, God loves a cheerful giver. You know, oftentimes for us, this is a little bit more difficult. Our kids are more natural at doing this. But we should celebrate that, and we should encourage that. You can have them give their tithe, but you can also look for things, for other ways for you to be able to give. Maybe it's a child sponsorship. Maybe it's giving to Samaritan's Purse or to Orphan Care. Or maybe you find someone on the side of the road who's in need. That's an opportunity for your children to see you giving, but you're doing it together as a family. So we begin within, and we focus on the family. And then kind of the third thing there is this. We need to reach for resources. Obviously, we want to keep the Word of God as the central focal point for everything that we do, and everything that we do, even as parents, should be grounded on God's Word. But a couple things that you can write in here is that we partner with the local church. Pastor talked about this earlier, that oftentimes people just think it's the job of the local church completely, but instead we want to partner together. That's why the church exists, is to be able to support you. One of the reasons that we exist is to support you in the home and help you to disciple your children. We do this by Sunday school. Gospel Project is a fantastic family discipleship tool if you're not using that. Awana can be this, a family discipleship tool. Us as pastors, we're here to talk with you and to counsel with you and hopefully help you in your family so that you can point your kids back to Christ. So we partner with the local church, and then the last one is that we read recommended resources. Sometimes the problem with the list that we that was given out tonight is there are a lot of books on there. You say, man, I haven't read a book in the last 12 months. How am I going to get through all of these? Pick one. Pick one book and say, hey, as a husband and wife team, we're going to read this together, or we're going to go through this together, and we're going to discuss it and see how it can be used in our home. That's one of the things that Pastor Kyler and I do together. We talk about these resources, and we'd love to be able to recommend some of these to you. You know, the thing about all of these things is that none of these are really earth-shattering ideas. They're everyday, simple things, and really that's the point. This doesn't need to be some difficult program or some experiment that we don't really know how to do, but just taking the little everyday things that we do and how do we center them on Christ. Some days are going to be better than others. Some of our kids are going to be easier and they're going to respond better than others, but our goal is to be intentional. Think about the things that God has laid on your heart tonight, and how can you be more intentional about discipling our children for the glory of God. Would you guys please welcome Pastor Kyler back as he concludes our evening. Give him a big round of applause, guys.
Let me just give you one last parting word. What I'm about to say, I mean every word that's going to come out. So I want you to just think about the way I phrase this. Your children have been entrusted to you. So if that's true, then that means somebody has done the entrusting, and it wasn't you. So the implication is that your children are not your own. They are God's, and they have been given to you. You have been called by God to steward your children for the very short amount of time you have them, 18 years, and it goes by like that. Many of you have children that are beyond that, and you can attest to this. And so our prayer for you, our encouragement to you, our admonition to you is that you would recognize the calling God has placed on your life, that you have been tasked with this. It actually has not been the church. The church exists, as Kyle pointed out, to partner with you. But you have been called to do what seems impossible, does it not? I wonder if that resonates with you, that every single parent I know feels inadequate on the front end and guilty on the back end. Perhaps as you heard some of these tips that Kyle walked us through and some of the things that I may have shared at the beginning, all it conjures up in your mind is failure and all the ways you've fallen short. And if that is something you're sensing in your own heart right now, perhaps you just have a little baby and you already sense this, then let me just say that is the best place to be. If that's the disposition of your heart right now, that is good, because that means you are utterly dependent on somebody else. And that's where I pray as we leave, and I will pray for you, that that would be the disposition of your hearts as parents, that you would find yourselves to be utterly dependent on the God who can help you do the impossible. Parenting can feel impossible. Sometimes the calling that it seems God has placed on you is just too much to bear. You try your best, but you see all the multitude of ways you fall short. And so let me just close by giving you one encouragement from the Bible. I would actually encourage you to maybe commit this verse to memory. You've heard it before. Pastor preached it a couple years ago. But at the bottom of your notes on the backside, I listed Ephesians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. And these are verses that I pray that the Lord would let kind of simmer in your own mind as you parent, recognizing that in every weak moment and every failing moment, there is a God who, as verse 20 says, is able to do far more abundantly than all that you can ask or think. And so, according to the power at work within us, to Him, to this God, be the glory in this church and in Christ Jesus, and notice, throughout all the generations, including the generations that God has entrusted to you, forever and ever. Amen. My prayer for you is that you would consider the question that God has placed to you from His Word, and that is, where is your target? Would you join me as we pray, and we'll be dismissed. Father, we thank You that as undeserving and weak and feeble and inadequate each of us are, You are adequate. You are strong. You are able. You are sufficient. You are what we are not. And so we praise You that it is Your promise and Your word that You will sustain us. Indeed, You are magnified. You are glorified. You are greatest when we are weakest. You are glorified when we are dependent. And so I pray that for these dear brothers and sisters in this room, that You would make them men and women, mothers and fathers, who are utterly dependent on You for every breath that they breathe, indeed for the calling they have as parents. And I pray that You would work in and through them. In spite of all of the shortcomings we bring to the table, I pray that You would use us to raise up a generation whose hope is in You, Lord Jesus, who love You more than anything this world has to offer. And we know that our example all too often does not reflect this reality. Though in our heads we want to say this is true, though in our minds we want to say this is what we ought to be doing, this is what I want to do, we recognize that our lives don't reflect it. And so we pray that You would so work in our hearts, as Kyle mentioned, that we would begin within, that You would start this work in the hearts of these parents, and that the overflow of the work You do in our hearts would be a life centered on raising up children, Lord Jesus, who love You. We pray, Lord, that You would do what only You can do to change the hearts of the children You've entrusted us. We know they're Yours, and we thank You that You have given them to us for a season. And we pray, Lord, that You would do what only You can do to change their hearts, and that You would do, Lord, what only You can do to lead them in the way that You would have them to go. And use us, we pray, as a means to that, and help us to fix our minds and our hearts on the target You have given us. And we're trusting that You will do this because we recognize we fail. And so we praise You that You are gracious, You are kind, You are merciful. You are a strength-giving God when we are weak. And we ask that You would receive all the glory that's due Your name in our calling as parents. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen.